We're continuing in the Gospel of John. This will be our 15th exposition. We're going to be in the first chapter, verses 38 and 39. Now, we're going to see confirmed in this text that when Jesus is properly introduced, and I'm careful to say properly introduced, he draws the attention of the people who hear and believe. So some people, they have not been exposed to the gospel, so they're not really drawn to Jesus. See, that's what the trouble is. But when the real Jesus is proclaimed in the real way, he draws people that believe that message.
Amen.
They come to him.
Yeah,
and he has no lasting appeal to anyone else. He really doesn't.
Yeah.
Jesus is never introduced in Scripture as the resolver of all human dilemmas. He's never presented that way. Although he is, if dilemmas are intended to be resolved, he is the resolver of dilemmas. But that's not how he's presented. The real problem is defined for us. It's sin that has alienated men from God. That is the problem. That is the problem that Jesus is addressing. The target is to reconcile alienated people to God. That's Project Humanity. He has not been provided to teach people how to be successful in the world. That's not why Jesus came. He's rather to prepare people to confront God at the day of judgment, which they're going to do, and to survive the confrontation and be able to dwell forever with the Lord. That's what Jesus is doing. Everything narrows down to that. And the Father draws people to Jesus. There's divinities involved in this whole process. God draws people to Christ. The Holy Spirit prepares them by convicting them of sin, righteousness, and judgment to come. The holy angels make sure they get there. They're ministering to those who are the heirs of salvation. And all of this is to make them willing to be delivered from sin. Anyone who is willing to be delivered from sin will be. That's what this is about. And see, no person who doesn't know about Christ is even thinking about deliverance from sin. This isn't the way men think. They think of being delivered from trouble or from habits, but not from sin. They don't even think this way. But this becomes a dominant thought when they hear of Jesus. They believe the real Jesus. They believe what they hear, and then they make their way to him, to get to him. This kind of activity, the Father drawing them, the Holy Spirit convicting them, holy angels clearing the way, Jesus welcoming them. This is involved in every conversion. These things are involved. Any other Jesus is another Jesus that will not be able to do what Jesus is able to do. Now, see, we have a dilemma that we face today. Some people don't like to face it, but if you're going to labor for God, you've got to face this dilemma. We've got people that say that they've believed that remain in bondage to sin. That's the situation. It's a situation that is impossible if you're in Christ.
Amen.
This means that there's another Jesus has been preached, and the Jesus that has been preached is not able to liberate the people from sin.
Yeah.
That's why they employ all these methods and techniques to help people be better, because the Jesus they preach can't deliver them. Because it's not the real Jesus. It doesn't make any difference what is inhibiting you from coming to God. If you want to come to Jesus, Jesus liberates you from whatever that inhibition is. You may be a Gadarene demoniac. Mm-hmm. He'll deliver whatever. The people will get to Jesus and be delivered if they will hear about the real Jesus and believe what is said. Salvation, as Jonah said, is of the Lord from beginning to end. And in the end, after everything is concluded, so far as the world is concerned, salvation is going to be ascribed to God. Amen. Salvation unto God. It's all going to be ascribed to Him. And then, of course, it will be seen very clearly why that is the case. Now, as demonstrated in this text, all that remains is to point out who Jesus is, believe that, and the pursuit of Jesus commences. That's the way it works. That's what John the Baptist did. He alerted people. His job was to prepare the way for the Lord. Make a straight path so they could get to Jesus. So he proclaimed the real Jesus, and the pursuit began. And we're going to see tonight two men that believed what John said and what their response was, what they did. Anytime anyone pursues Jesus, they're always on the initiative to ask. They never have to be challenged to do. They ask.
Yeah, amen.
Men and brethren, what shall we do? Yeah. What must I do? You know, that this is what happens. John didn't tell these disciples we're going to read about to follow Jesus. He just says, there he is. That's what I was telling you about, to take away the sin of the world. There he is right there. That's all he had to say. He'd introduced.
Yeah, amen.
See, he'd introduced Jesus. So once they saw who he was, that's all that remained. Just where is he? And they pursued him. John 1. 38 and 39. Then Jesus turned and saw them following. And he saith unto them, What seek ye? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is to say, being interpreted, Master, where dwellest thou? He saith unto them, Come and see. They came and saw where he dwelt, and abode with him that day. For it was about the 10th hour. Now that's a very brief account, but there's a lot occurred during that account. Now in Scripture, you'll find that Jesus is always depicted as being alert and perceptive. He never says, huh? Or what was that? What happened? You know.
Yeah.
He's always perceptive of what's going on. Never caught off guard. If he asks a question, it isn't because he wants an answer. He knows what the answer is already. He's not unaware of the intentions of men. If you have noble intentions, I mean, if you really do, Jesus knows it.
Amen.
And he'll do something about it. You can bank on this now. This is not dreamy type stuff. This is very real. If you have noble ambitions that God considers noble, and you keep them, you don't let them die out, Jesus will answer them. That's the way this is. And I've often thought, what draws people to Jesus? It's his uniqueness. It's the fact that he's not like other men. That's the very thing that draws people. So, see, when people try and make Jesus like other men, they terminate the uniqueness, and people aren't going to come to the real Jesus. You know, that's a pretty smart ploy from the devil. That's from the devil, from the devil's point of view. Pretty smart ploy. No other man in history has ever been sent by God or anyone else to resolve the dilemma of sin. Jesus is it. Moses was sent to define sin. Noah was sent to survive sin. Yes?
It's just an interesting thought that most people today who know about Christ, that the thing that they object to is usually Christians and Christianity, not Jesus.
Not Jesus, that's
most
right.
Most people are intrigued by Jesus.
That's right. That's exactly right. He is intriguing. Because that's this uniqueness I was talking about. John prepared the way for the Lamb of God by calling men to repent. See, that's how he made the straight. Sin was the bottleneck. So John came and he addressed this matter of sin. He baptized with the baptism of repentance unto the remission of sins. All right, that got the bottleneck out of the way, the stone out of the way. Now Andrew, and we believe was John, the other disciple that was with John the Baptist, are drawn to Jesus when they heard, "Look, that's the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." Andrew and John are intrigued by this, and they start following Jesus. With Jesus going, when the first time they saw Jesus, he was coming to John. Now he's either leaving or passing by. Now the scripture says Jesus turned. Remember, it said Jesus never lacking perception. He always knows what's going on. We don't know how far behind these were. We don't know how far Jesus was away. He was within sight. But Jesus turned. Turning around or looking around or having turned, Jesus, Message Bible says Jesus looked over his shoulder. That's a little weak, I think, there. Now, this is the second time in the Gospel of John that Jesus turned. Turned to look at, see. Some people don't know that Jesus turns, faces something, head on. There's other times that we read about Jesus turning. The woman with the issue of blood, when she touched his garment, he turned, faced her. Next time we read about a woman who washed his feet, he turned to her and rebuked Simon, whose house he was at. Another time, he turned to James and John, who'd ask if he wanted them to call down fire from above, because there was a certain city that wouldn't receive Jesus, because they perceived he was headed for Jerusalem, so they wouldn't receive him. But James and John said, "Do you want us to call down fire?" And the scripture says he turned and said, "You know not what manner of spirit ye are of." See, when Jesus turns, that means listen up. Because he's just talking to the person he's turning to. That's who he's talking to. Another time he stopped to speak to a woman, Syrophoenician woman, who pled with him for her daughter, you remember. He turned to her. Jairus, when he called out, so Jesus said his daughter was dying, he says, he came to Jesus, and Jesus turned to pay attention to Jairus, the Syrophoenician woman. He turned to pay attention to her. The rich young ruler, he turned to pay attention to them. See, there were people that got Jesus' attention. He turned. You've got to see this Jesus. It's important that you see this Jesus. Some prayers are general because they don't see this. Jesus can turn face to face, you know. Deal right straight with you, whether anybody else is involved or not. He turned. We gather from this that any person that draws near to Jesus will not be ignored. If you press toward the mark,
amen,
you'll not be ignored.
Amen.
No, you won't. God said one time to Israel, "I said to the seed of Jacob, I said not unto the seed of Jacob, seek ye my face in vain." That means it's never pointless to seek God's face.
Amen.
This is never pointless. Amen. To follow Jesus, this is never pointless. It's never vain. It's never useless. Never.
Praise God.
So if a person's having trouble with Jesus paying attention to them, they just need to press in.
Yes, amen.
Press in. It's also written, draw nigh unto God, and he will draw nigh unto you. Yeah, that's this turning we're talking about. Now then, he turns, he faces Andrew and John and says, what seek ye? You know, he said, what do you want? Yeah, it almost sounds cold. It almost, what? Now you could read it different ways. You say, what do you want? You know, what do you want? What do you want? You know, you could read it different. But some people couldn't imagine Jesus saying something like that. Well, what do you want? Well, you want to be able to answer. If he asks you that question, you want to be able to answer. One version, New Revised Standard Version, says, what are you looking for? Another version says, what's your wish? Probing question. Two blind men confronted Jesus one time. He said to them, what will ye that I do unto you? What would you answer? If Jesus asked you, what do you want me to do to you? What? Tonight, like, what do you want me to do? What would you tell him? Some people would say, well, help me meet my next house payment. Some people, this is how some people think. Help me to be well. If you had the chance for one request to be answered, like, what would it be? What would you ask him? That's what he's saying. He's not saying, what things do you want me to do? What do you feel is the main thing? You're coming to me. What right now? What's the prominent thing?
Brother Gibbons, yeah. I was reminded whenever Mary and Martha were together,
right.
Jesus mentioned that Mary chose
the better thing,
the good thing. It was stronger than that as well.
That's right. Mm-hmm. It's important to think the thing out. Sometimes our prayers are almost wasted. He does say, let your request be made known. He doesn't say he's going to answer it all the time, but he'll give you peace. But think out what, if you sense the door's open to ask, at least ask something significant. What do you want me to do for you? He didn't always meet people's requests. He turned down the mother of James and John. She made a request, he turned it down. James and John made a request, he turned it down. A young man made a request to speak to his brother about the inheritance. He turned it down. So Jesus doesn't always do what people ask him to do. He said, what do you want? And his James, John mother said, well, let my sons, one sit on the right, one on the left. He said, no. Didn't answer. And he asked James and John. They asked the same thing. They conferred with their mother, evidently. And he didn't do it. So just because he asks you doesn't mean he's going to do what you ask. He said to James and John, you don't know what you're asking. You say, you need to think out what you're going to ask me to do. I think that needs to be said in our day. People need to think out what they want Jesus to do. What do you want Jesus to do?
Amen.
Think it out, because he's going to do it with discretion. Yeah. What do you want? What do you not? What do you want? Do you think this is something God wants done? Is this something that will bring glory to God or ease to you? Which you got to ask yourself. Is this the kind of thing the Savior would be inclined to do? When you say this, is he going to see right away that this is something I want to do for you too? When Jairus sought the healing of his daughter, he knew the kind of work Jesus was doing. He was going about healing all that were oppressed of the devil. See, so he asked something that was in keeping with what Jesus was doing. The Syrophoenician woman had a sick daughter. She knew he'd heard about Jesus healing. So she asked something. She knew Jesus was doing this kind of thing. It wasn't just a new thing. Now there's something else to be seen here. Jesus has a desire to do good to the people. He actually wants to do good. He went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Once a leper came to Jesus, worshiping him, and said, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Jesus put forth his hand and said, I will.
Amen.
I will. Yeah. I want to do this. He asked the right thing. Now he asked the right thing. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. A certain centurion came to Jesus and said, Lord, my servant lieth home at sick of the palsy, previously tormented. And Jesus said, I will come and heal him. How's that? How's that? He didn't even ask him. He just told him the condition. He said, I'll come and heal him. That tells you something about Jesus. Jesus said to his disciples, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Oh, that sounds good. I like to hear that. Yeah. I say, well, I want to know more about this asking in Jesus' name. I want a little more understanding of that. Because Jesus said, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. That's what he said. So I'm pointing out here that what you want is not the only thing involved. Jesus wants to do something too. And when your will and his will sinks, well, that parallels what John said. If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And we know that if he hears us, we'll have the petition. See, it's perfectly in sync with that, what he said. So Jesus, yes. Now, he knew what they wanted. But this is Jesus' manner. He draws. He wants your involvement in the thing. He already knows what you need. He already knows what you're going to ask. But he draws that out. What do you want me to do? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is interpreted master, which means teachers. Master means, in terms of master, doesn't mean head. It means teacher, what it means. That's where we get schoolmaster. He's a teacher. Nathanael also addressed Jesus as Rabbi, John 1:49. Nicodemus called him a teacher. We know that a teacher. Yes, Judah.
Off of this, what's this point of what seek ye? Part of the point, even though Jesus already knows what you need, and he knows what you're going to ask, it's part of him making you realize that you need to be humble. I'm not going to be able to communicate this as well as I can see it, probably. But when you can tell Jesus, I need this, That means you recognize that you can't get it for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of humbling yourself before him.
That's good.
So that he can exalt you in due time. And he can give you what you need.
That's good.
Yeah,
just to kind of go along with that, Brother Given, I was thinking that when he asks that it causes you to examine yourself.
That's right.
See,
amen.
See what your motives are. So
amen.
The Lord will still do this. He'll ask, what are you really wanting? So it'll cause you to examine your faith and your motives.
Now I will tell you that I'm persuaded a lot of people cannot conceive of a Jesus asking you what you want. It's always just you asking what you want, but it's coming the other way. And I think a lot of people have never seen this about Jesus. Now, what do you want? You might say, well, how much of me have you really seen? Why are you here? So they said, Master, Nicodemus said, we know you're a teacher sent from God. 11 times in Scripture, Jesus is said to be teaching. 24 times, Jesus is said to have taught. Jesus called people to learn from me. In this day of salvation, he's depicted as giving us an understanding. And we talk about the real Jesus now. Those who are in him are said to be taught by him, Ephesians 4:20. And notice what teaches in that text, Ephesians 4:20 and 21. Notice what Jesus teaches. He teaches put on the new man. Put off the old man. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. That's what he teaches. You're taught of Christ. It's what he teaches. So if you have this driving compulsion to put on the new man, or to put it another way, yield your members as instruments of righteousness. If this is a driving compulsion, Jesus has been teaching you.
Amen. Praise
yeah?
God. Yes.
Amen. If there's certain things you I got to put this off. I got to put this off. I have to lay this aside. Jesus has been teaching you. If you have this burning desire, I need to have a fresh mind. I've got to look into this in a better way. Jesus has been teaching you. He's a teacher. That's what Jesus is. When the enemies of Jesus sought to trap him, they dealt with what he taught. They said, "Master, we know that thou sayest and teachest rightly. Neither acceptest thou any the purse of any, but teachest the way of God truly. Is it lawful for us to give tribute to Caesar?" See, they ask him that as a teacher. Few people today think of Jesus as a teacher. It just isn't a common way of thinking about Jesus. You hear very few people refer to Jesus as a teacher. But he is. He's a teacher. This is early enough. This is at the threshold of his ministry. Already he's known as a teacher. At the threshold of his ministry.
Brother, I was thinking this is significant. Was that they're just going, these two men are just going on John's testimony.
That's right.
The power
that's
of John's testimony.
That's right.
Their first address to Jesus is teacher.
Teacher, and that's how it is. It's very significant. John prepared the way, see?
He,
not only by telling them what to do, but opening their eyes to what Jesus would do.
Yeah. They'd not heard Jesus teach anything.
No, not yet, no. Isn't that something? I think God was involved in this. No question. Only the ministry of John the Baptist preceded him so far as the direct ministry was concerned, yet he's called teacher, rabbi. Jesus has all but disappeared from the vocabulary of the modern church under the leadership of erroneous hirelings. This has resulted from what's being taught. What has been taught for the past few decades, and maybe more, what has been taught to the church has veiled the fact that Jesus is a teacher. So when men want to learn something, they go to the wisdom of men.
Yep.
Amen. Why do they go to the wisdom of men? And techniques that men have invented. Why do they do that? Because they do not see Jesus as a teacher. That's what the problem is. But Jesus is a teacher. Sent from God. Nicodemus had it right. We know thou art a teacher sent from God. They knew that. Well, what do you suppose they answer? What do you want me to do? Just tell us where you're staying. Tell us where you're residing. Just tell us where you're dwelling. They're thinking of the future, see?
Yeah.
They're thinking of an ongoing situation. Where remainest thou, one version says. You noticed they didn't say, where are you going? They didn't say that. You know, where are you staying? They just didn't. I get the idea they weren't interested in like merging in with another crowd someplace else. They wanted some personal concourse with the Lord Jesus, not just another place he'd be holding the meeting, so to speak. Where dwellest thou? Now we're apprised by Matthew that Jesus left Nazareth and came to dwell in Capernaum, which is upon the seacoast in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. Mark 2:1 suggests he had a house there. So some think that that's where he was staying, but no, this is not right. Because he left Nazareth after John was imprisoned. Scriptures make this, but after John was imprisoned. So he hadn't made this formal move from Nazareth yet at this time. Because John wasn't in prison. He's still preaching down by Galilee, down in Judea, I mean. So this was some kind of temporary residence. We don't know where it was. We don't know anything about it. But it was someplace nobody else knew anything about either. Some suggest it might have been a private home. It might have been a cave dwelling. Who knows where it was? They didn't care where it was. They just want to know where it was. Amen. Where are you staying? Yes.
Seeking Christ to know where he dwells and to dwell there also is far superior to seeking him to receive a healing or some kind of impartation, only to go back to what you were doing beforehand.
Yeah. Good. Amen. Yeah, see, this means they want to be with him rather than wanting him to be with them. That's right. See, now that you've made some progress when the main thing to you is being where Jesus is. You've made some progress. So what does Jesus say? He's, well, just down the road here. No, he says, come and see. God, he doesn't tell him. Just, no. You want to know where I stay? You have to be with me and follow me.
Amen.
Come and see. They'd have to go with him if they knew. Seems to me that this is a divine manner. You want to know what I'm doing? What are you doing, Lord? Do you want to know what I'm doing? You'll have to follow me. Yes?
It means you've got to stop what you're doing.
That's right.
In order to know where he's going.
That's right. It's actually relatively simple, but see, it's overlooked by a lot of people. They're trying to get Jesus to be where they are.
Yeah.
Instead of wanting to know where he is so they can be where he is. Amen. See, ultimately, we're going to be where he is. He said, if I go again, I will come again, take you to myself to where I am. There you may be. So that's the kind of the mode of the kingdom, is to be where Jesus is instead of having Jesus be where you are. Amen. Matter of fact, where two or more gather together in my name, he doesn't say, there will I come. He says, there am I. There I am. So they went where he was, rather than him going where they were.
Uh-huh.
But see, there's a whole approach to having Jesus in your presence that has to do with making an environment into which Jesus comes. This whole modern praise movement, this is the whole posture of the movement. You produce an environment into which Jesus comes. But the way it really works is you go into the environment where Jesus is. All the difference in the world. There's no long distance learning, in other words, in the kingdom of God. In the end, Jesus is going to say, behold, I am the children. We're going to be there. He's not going to be here. Behold, I am the children thou hast given me. We're all here. See, that's the way it's going to end up, and that's the way you've got to learn. You've got to learn to be where Jesus is. Now, you can live with two different motives in mind. I won't say it's altogether wrong to ask the Lord to turn up where you are. I won't say it's altogether wrong, but it's not altogether right either. The right mode is for you to be where he is.
Amen.
Same with John the Baptist teaching. You want to hear John, you had to be where he was. You couldn't import John, have John hold you a revival meeting. You had to be where he was. To hear Jesus, you had to go where he was. So these disciples sense that. See, where do you live? Where are you dwelling? Yes, brother.
John said, if we walk in the light as he
is. As he is in the light.
In the light. That's where the benefit is.
That's right.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Now, it's a, I think that most of you know this already, but a lot of people will have to adjust their thinking. This is not the way they're taught to think. They're taught to think we've got to get things ready so Jesus will want to be where we are. But the readiness is you making you want to be where he is. If a great distance exists between Jesus and the people, an even greater distance exists between the people and God. See, because you're only as close to God as you are to Christ. So if Jesus shows you where he dwells, you're going to be closer to God by virtue of that position. These two disciples are an example of the effectiveness of John's ministry. Now, John had been ministering for 6 months. He started when he was 30. Jesus started when he was 30. And there was 6 months difference in their age. He'd been preaching 6 months. Now, that would not be considered a long ministry in any church. Uh-huh. If someone told you they just ministered 6 months, someone would say, well, something was really wrong there. But that's how he'd just been ministering 6 months. But during that 6 months, whenever Andrew and John first went to see him, and I have an idea, it was at the beginning. Within that 6 months period, they had developed an unquenchable appetite to be where the Messiah was.
Amen.
Okay, so people that have heard the invitation for 15 years and never come, I mean, something's wrong.
Yeah, that's right.
Something's wrong here. They came and saw. They did just exactly. Jesus said, come and see. They came and saw.
Yeah, a couple of thoughts on Jesus as a teacher. I was thinking of how Jesus, it often says he taught the crowds. It says he taught them in parables.
Yeah.
And one time it says he didn't teach them except in a parable.
Except in a parable.
And you get the idea there that probably a lot of people went away scratching their heads, not really knowing. But then to his disciples,
he
would explain it. And they would ask him, they said, Lord, explain to us the parable of the tares.
Yeah.
And he'd give them the meaning. Yeah. So there's some teaching, see, that only takes place for people like who ask,
amen,
who are interested, amen, who are following Jesus. But see, the crowds, you get the idea, the crowds, sometimes it says they heard him gladly, but you don't always know that they like understood what he was saying.
That's right. Mm. He didn't speak in parables to the two on the road to Emmaus. He didn't speak in parables to them. So that is right. Absolutely right. Well, they came. They went with him. I have an idea. Who knows about this trip? That must have been some trip. Now, we don't have the details of it, but I imagine it paralleled a lot of Jesus with the two on the road to Emmaus when he opened to them the scriptures concerning himself. I don't doubt that he was doing a lot of this was before he died, but that he was doing something like that, confirming who he was. The psalmist in Psalm 55:14 says, we took sweet counsel together and walked into the house of God in company. I have an idea that's the kind of thing that that happened during that walk. And they saw where he dwelt. Now they saw more than a building. They saw where he dwelt. Whatever they saw, whatever it was, a tent, a building, or whatever it was that he dwelt there that gave it its significance. They saw where he dwelt. A place where he could be found, as Brother Tony suggested. See, it's a place where he could be found. John had introduced him as a Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. John had said he is one that baptizes with the Holy Spirit. John had said he's the one that's purging fans in his hand. Amen. This is what John said about Jesus. He's going to thoroughly purge his floor. He's going to gather his wheat into his barn. He's preferred, John said, over me. I saw the Spirit of God descending upon him in the form of a dove and remaining. See, so this is what John told him about Jesus. It was enough. That's enough. We want to know where he dwells. We want to know where this person dwells. We want more access to him. Now, it's no different today, brother. It's no different today. When people hear the truth about Jesus and believe it, they'll be compelled to be where he is. Now, all of us have had this disappointment where we went someplace where we thought Jesus would be, but there wasn't any evidence that he was there. I mean, if you can recall what disappointment that registered. That'd be like them thinking Jesus was a certain dwell in a certain place and went there, and someone said, we never heard of a man. He doesn't dwell here. See what disappointment that would be. But there's people that have been disappointed. They've been told. They've been led to believe that Jesus is here, Jesus is there. And then they go, and it's just a powerless of places any other place they'd been. He isn't there. They'll find other things to do. When Jesus isn't there, then the people find some other things to do. And they may be eventually lost. But when Jesus is near, those who are convinced of who he is will stop work, sit down, and hear what he has to say. They'll listen. Now, I've been places, and now I'm quite often in this kind of place where when what's being said is being said, I don't want to be interrupted. It's that important. I don't want to be interrupted. See, you've experienced this. You're receiving. You're where the Lord Jesus is.
Amen.
You don't want that taken from you. Mm-hmm. And there are a variety of ways Satan will try and divert your attention. He's got tricks, you know, ploys, try and divert your attention. But your quest for Jesus will be stronger. If you keep it, it'll be stronger, and you will not be diverted. It's important here, I think, to say also that Jesus sanctifies the place. The place doesn't sanctify Jesus. There really is no place to be more desired than the place where Jesus is residing. Ultimately, that's at the right hand of God.
Yeah.
That's where we're headed, brother. That's where we're headed. We're going to sit with him in his throne. That's where we're headed. That's the ultimate place of residence. And with the prominence of architecture and religion, there's a tendency for people to think the place is what sanctifies the people. They get inside this building, and that's what does it. But Jesus is what sanctifies the place. If Jesus isn't there, the temple can be nothing more than a house of merchandise. When Jesus turned up now, he stopped that from being a house of merchandise. They were using the temple to buy and sell and get gain. Until Jesus showed up. And he sanctified the place. And he was not polite about doing it. He didn't ask them to leave because they were out of order being in his Father's house. Jesus sanctifies the place. Others who have private interpretations of Jesus' ministry, and I was once among these people, so I this isn't hearsay. I know they teach this because I was exposed to it, that what Jesus taught was under the law and is not applicable to us today. You taught that too, aren't you, Brother Tony? We were taught that. Well, if that's the case, then where Jesus is doesn't sanctify the place. Then his words aren't really spirit and life, but he said they were.
Amen.
Now this text was happening when the sun of righteousness was just starting to rise. And already we've learned teacher. So already we see him as a teacher. It's at the beginning now. Already where he is deemed the most important thing to people of interest, where he abides. And what did they do? They stayed with him the whole day. He apparently arrived at the place about 4 p.m. That's the 10th hour of the day. First hour being 6 a.m. The 10th hour being 4 p.m. He arrived about that time. Some people have a lot of trouble interpreting when this was. They say they're not sure whether John used the Roman daytime, the Roman time, or the Hebrew time. The Roman time is like our time. The day starts at midnight. So the 10th hour would be 10 in the morning. Hebrew time is two different sections of 12 hours, and the 10th hour of the day would be 4 p.m. And some people just can't figure it out. You know, they have a hard time figuring it out. Which I don't understand, because Jesus said that there are not 12 hours in a day. And in the creation, he made two periods, day and night. So it's inconceivable that people who knew God would use Roman time. This is inconceivable. Because God established two different day and night. They're two different periods. They're not just one half a day and the other half of the day. Well, they're two different periods completely. So I gather this was 4 p.m. They probably walked considerable distance. We don't know how long, but probably was in the vicinity of 20-some miles. But they weren't too tired to talk or too tired to stay up. Matter of fact, they may have spent the night. I wouldn't doubt what they were like Paul, waited till the break of day. If people stayed to listen to Paul, I mean, don't you know these men would stay to listen to Christ? They once they got there, they spent the day. Now Jesus had a ministry. He was going to be going places, doing good. But they spent as much time with him as they could. Amen. That's how I see this. Now there's also a unity realized here. I gather this was the same thing that happened to the two on the road to Emmaus. They said, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way? Did not our heart, plural, heart, singular, burn within us? Several more modern versions incorrectly read hearts. I give them to you there. They say, did not our hearts burn within us? But the word used here in the original language is singular. Did not our heart. God promised in Ezekiel 11:19, I will give them one heart. I will give them, plural, one singular heart. See, God's people have one heart. It's a united heart. One heart. And it's verified in Acts 4:32, the multitude of them that believed were of one heart. See? So you learn this when you're with Jesus. There's one heart. It's actually the heart of Jesus, but you participate. You mean you think the same way. You think the same way. You have the same kind of affection. You have the same kind of purpose. Well, it doesn't mean everybody's understanding is in sync, but it means it's not out of harmony. Amen. It's not out of harmony at all. Singular heart affects the very nature, reflects the very nature of faith. You can't have a common faith consists of people with different perceptions. See this? This doesn't work. If you see it all, what you see and what I see are the same. The difference is what people don't see. There's not as I see it. There really technically if you really see it, you see it the same way as the other person sees it, because it's one heart.
Amen.
And truth is in the singular also. So the secret to genuine unity is not consensus. It's not talking the thing out and arriving at a common conclusion. The secret to unity is to all be with Christ, where He is. That's the secret to unity. And when that happens, unity will happen also. And we'll find ourselves growing closer to God and closer to one another. And all of that, it sounds almost overly simplistic, I know. But because of the way people have been taught and how they reason, it's hard for them to think of Jesus as a teacher or a thinker or a speaker. It's hard for them to think of Jesus in that way. Because this is not how they've been introduced to Jesus. Jesus is more like a genie or a butler. This is how they think of Him now. But He's not. That's not what He is. We're the butler. Yeah. Yes.
Of Jesus as part of a system of some sort. So there's a lot of, it's a kind of a depersonalization.
That's good.
Whereas with the disciples, if you read the Gospels, it's very personal.
Yes.
They're with Jesus. In fact, that was the whole point. There really wasn't any, that was what they did.
That's right.
These disciples, they were with Him. Remember in Acts it says, when Judas hung himself, they said, we need to get someone who was with Him to replace Him. So that was the whole point, was that they were with Him. And whatever fault you read about in the Gospels, and you sometimes the disciples, they didn't understand things, and Jesus said, oh, you're slow of heart, or he'd say, oh, you have little faith. But whatever you may say about these men, and the women too, remember it talks about the women disciples.
They followed Him too.
Whatever you might say about these people at this point, they were doing the right thing.
They were with Jesus. Right.
But there were a lot of other people, see, that weren't with Jesus.
Left Him. Someone said they left Him.
So at the minimum, you've got to be with Jesus. Now once you're with Jesus, whatever deficiencies you have, all of us bring deficiencies, those things are corrected or mitigated when we're with Jesus.
Amen.
But if you're not with Him, those things, see, it can't be addressed. You're not even meeting the minimum requirement.
That's right.
If you're not taking up your cross and following Him. Amen. You've got to at least do that.
Amen.
As soon as the disciples pulled up alongside of Jesus, He immediately began to teach them.
Yes.
It tickled me because He said, come and see.
Come and see.
The teaching begun. So He wanted them to come and be an eyewitness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where he lived, where he abode, where he stayed. And so that, of course, that they would be His disciples, you see.
Amen.
And it's tremendous. Now, just like you said in the lesson, that it's the same today.
Amen.
You know, we come alongside Jesus immediately begins to teach.
In the earth, Jesus wasn't always in the place of His abode.
That's right.
Left His abode, came back to it. Now Jesus is
always in His abode.
In the place of His abode.
Amen.
So it's an encouragement for God's people, if they want to be where He is, to get where He is. You know what
Amen.
I mean? And that's where you can always find Him.
That's how you start out. Seated with Christ in heavenly places. Mm.
And it's intended. That's intended for God's people to be there always. Not to go away and then come back and go away and come back. That smacks too much of Old Covenant style to me.
I'm not sure you can go away and come back and go away and come back. Because there comes a time when you won't be able to go back.
Yeah.
I remember that at the end of John's Gospel. Remember Peter, Jesus are there, and Jesus says, you know, do you love Me? Do you love Me? Do you love Me? And then, remember, it says they saw John following.
Yeah.
Peter says, what about him?
Yeah.
What is it to you if he remains until I come? You follow me.
Yeah. Then the same went abroad that John wasn't going to die.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's a sense in which, that's like your main commission. That's the Great Commission. Follow,
follow me.
And you follow him regardless of what everybody else is doing.
Amen.
You follow him. It greatly simplifies things.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Good.
All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of following Jesus, knowing where he dwells, and taking up residence with him. Words fail us to express what a wonderful benefit this is. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.